All right. Welcome everyone to the Flint Community Webinar, your community resource every Friday at noon. We're a little bit different today. We are actually broadcasting live from the Healthy Flint Research Coordinating Center's Research Symposium. So hopefully you're here enjoying the symposium with us. If you're not, hopefully you're also watching this archived on our YouTube channel. So we always provide a couple different ways for you to connect with the resources shared through our weekly webinar. And talking about resources, we have some amazing speakers. Two, I don't think we've had on the webinar, and then one revisiting us. I forgot to even introduce myself. We just jumped into the work. I'm Heather Lynn Uphold. I'm faculty at Michigan State University here in Flint, your moderator today. Excited to be here with you. We're going to be talking about lung cancer and specifically screening and prevention. So we've got Dr. Kristen Mackey. She's an assistant professor in the Department of Oncology in the School of Medicine down in at Wayne State University. Go Warriors. I'm an alum. And then we also have Dr. Keith English and Dr. Brittany Taylor. They are here. They're going to talk to us about millions of lives saved. So the impact of vaccines, critical information as we're headed into flu and COVID and season where we need to be mindful of our vaccines and understand the importance of them. Dr. English is a professor and chair in the Department of Pediatrics and Human Development in the College of Human Medicine at MSU. And Brittany, you all know Brittany. She's amazing. She's the Alice Hamilton Scholar for PPHI. That's the Pediatric Public Health Initiative. And she's also an internist and pediatrician. So first up is Kristen. So Kristen, go ahead and share slides. Carl, we're going to save that announcement for a while. We're going to save that slide too, so you can stop sharing slides. And we will turn things over to Kristen, and she's going to talk to us about lung cancer.
Great. Thank you. Can you see my slides?
Not yet. Give it a go again.
Okay. Let me end this share. Oh, there we go. There we go. Yep. I think I hit my presentation mode a second too early. So thank you for having me here. I'll say I just had my updated COVID shot, so I hope everybody else gets theirs soon too if they haven't already, but I will be talking about lung cancer screening. So first, I'll give you a little bit of a background on lung cancer screening and then talk about some of the challenges related to lung cancer screening and then some special risk factors and considerations in East Michigan. And I will wrap up with some future directions with some community listening sessions that we will be holding, and we have already held a couple. So lung cancer is a leading cause of cancer-related death in the United States among both males and females. Lung cancer screening is fairly new compared to other types of cancer screening, such as breast cancer screening or colorectal cancer screening. So the results of the National Lung Screening Trial, or the NLST, were published in 2011, and they showed that annual screening with low-dose CT scans can reduce lung cancer deaths by 16 to 20%. The population that was included with the NLST was older adults who had a fairly heavy smoking history. So because of this, the recommendations and eligibility criteria for lung cancer screening focus heavily on age as well as smoking history. So the current recommendation from the United States Preventive Services Task Force suggests that people who are between 50 and 80 years old and who have a 20 pack year smoking history or more be eligible for lung cancer screening. So the pack year smoking history is calculated by multiplying the average number of packs of cigarettes a person smokes per day by the number of years that they have smoked. So for example, if you have smoked 2 packs per day for 10 years, that would be 20 pack years. 4 packs a day for 5 years would be 20 pack years, and so on. So it really varies quite a bit in terms of the intensity of the smoking history, as well as the length of time the person has been smoking. Also, a person needs to smoke currently or have quit within 15 years to be eligible for lung cancer screening. And they need to be willing or able to have follow-up tests or continue annual screening until they are no longer eligible, which is usually either becoming over the age limit of 80 years old or having something diagnosed that they would then not need to be doing annual screening because they would shift into treatment. Also, a shared decision-making consultation is recommended. And for people who are covered by Medicare or Medicaid, they need to have this documented by a health professional. So the shared decision-making consultation is really aimed at helping people make a decision that aligns with their values. And for lung cancer screening, the person conducting the shared decision-making consultation would talk about potential harms and benefits related to screening. So the potential harms are a false positive where something is diagnosed as a lung cancer that is not actually a cancer, a false negative, which is the opposite, where the scan says everything's okay, but the person actually does have cancer. Overdiagnosis is a tricky concept to wrap your mind around because that's diagnosing something that wouldn't have actually truly harmed a person in their lifetime. So that, like I said, is something that's difficult to quantify, but is a potential harm of screening, as well as radiation exposure. So even though lung cancer screening uses the low-dose CT scan, which has a pretty low level of radiation exposure, it still adds to the cumulative radiation exposure that people experience just through daily life as well. Other potential harms include anxiety about scanning, as well as potential financial cost related to follow-up care and diagnostics from lung cancer treatment. So lung cancer screening, the low-dose CT scan itself, is covered by insurance based on the Affordable Care Act. It is required to be covered for people who are eligible, but follow-up diagnostics or other treatments aren't necessarily covered by insurance as much. So that is another potential limitation as well. The potential benefits, though, are reduced risk of death due to lung cancer, as well as other causes, because the scan can show something else that is wrong that can be treated at a more treatable stage. So those are the potential harms and benefits. And along with talking about those, the health professional who is conducting the shared decision-making consultation also needs to talk to the person about the importance of going through screening every year to see the benefit of screening, as well as smoking cessation or staying quit if the person has quit. And after all of that, they go through everything and find out what matters most to the patient and then make a decision together about whether to continue with screening or to wait and maybe revisit screening another year. So that is the process. And because lung cancer screening is one of the newer screening mechanisms, it was able to be tied with the lung cancer screening. So shared decision making is suggested for several other cancer screening and treatment options, including PSA screening for prostate cancer. But because the lung cancer screening is a newer type of test and shared decision making is also newer, it was able to be paired together in terms of requirements rather than adding a shared decision making requirement with some of the other tests that were already in place. So that's why you don't see shared decision making as a requirement as often with some of the other prevention measures. There have been some challenges related to lung cancer screening, partly because it is a newer type of cancer screening. The uptake has been fairly low. So estimates suggest that less than 20% of eligible adults are screened for lung cancer, along with lack of awareness, both for patients and sometimes providers. Stigma could be a barrier to screening uptake. So because of the association with tobacco use as one of the primary risk factors, patients can sometimes feel stigmatized about past or current tobacco use. And also, just if you look at some of the social determinants of health, there's a lot of overlap between people who use tobacco products and are also less likely to use preventive care for a number of reasons, including lack of health insurance, accessibility to facilities, and other reasons like that. So low uptake has been one of the challenges with shared decision making. Another issue has been the quality of decision support materials for shared decision making. So like I said, this is required for patients who have Medicare and Medicaid coverage to have this type of conversation with their health professional. in the example that I have on the screen, you can see that there's a lot going on. So it includes information about the eligibility criteria, a pack years calculator, what to expect during the scan, which I will say I'm not a clinician, but the scan itself is pretty easy. So you go through the CT machine, you have your arms above your head, and you're in and out in a minute or two. There's no needles. There's no prep that you have to do for it. As participants in one of our recent listening sessions, we're excited to find out you typically get to keep the same clothes that you walk in. You get to have those as you go through the scan, as long as they're like CT scan okay clothes. So it's the procedure itself is pretty straightforward. And then afterward, you follow up with the next steps, which is either diagnostics if something is found, or annual screening if you just need to continue. But the quality of the materials to go through all of that information either have a lot going on a single page like this, or in general, that's a lot of information that is typically conveyed at a very high reading level and is just kind of confusing for patients. So I have been working with some colleagues on a review of these materials, and overall, we found that the average reading level for these materials tends to be at least like a 10th or 11th grade reading level, which is way higher than the recommendation of, I believe it's around a 6th grade reading level is around the recommended level for that. So the quality of these materials has definitely also been a challenge. And once people do get into screening, another issue has been poor adherence to annual screening. So there has been some misunderstanding that it's a one-time thing. You go once and you're done. That isn't the case. In order to really see the benefit of lung cancer screening, you need to go every year until you're not eligible. So in doing a systematic review of some real-world clinical setting studies, some colleagues and I ended up seeing that not only was adherence measured for a shorter amount of time, so on average 18 months as opposed to 3 years, which was what was done with the NLST, the adherence rate for that was still only about 55%, so about half the time and about half the adherence level. So what's been seen in clinical settings is really, really low compared to the clinical trials. So we likely aren't seeing the full benefit of lung cancer screening in clinical settings compared to the clinical trials, because the NLST and some of the other major lung screening trials have seen adherence of about 95% rather than 55%. So that's another big challenge once we get people to screen, to continue screening until they aren't eligible. I'll shift into some of the other accessibility issues, which include how difficult it can be to get to a screening facility. So if I had a map of the whole US instead of just Michigan, you would see big clusters of these screening facilities in the Northeast and on the West Coast, which is great because there's great healthcare in both of those regions. But the proportion of people who are eligible for lung cancer screening, there's really a higher proportion of those people in the Midwest and the South. And it's a little more difficult to get screened in the Midwest and the South, as well as the Southwest that has a band of not many facilities. But this is partly because these facilities tend to be clustered around larger metro areas where there are a lot of people. And you see this in the map for Michigan, where there are about 111 lung cancer screening facilities that are within Michigan. And you can see that most of them are clustered around Metro Detroit. So that is where we have a high population of people. It makes sense, but it can be difficult for other people in different areas within the state to get the screening that they need without having to travel too far. So to give you an idea, within Genesee County, in Flint, if you search for facilities using a zip code for Flint and search within 10 miles, there are 4 screening facilities and 2 of them are located in Flint. So that's not too bad for the people in Flint within Genesee County. But if you look at Linden, there are only two facilities about 4 miles and 10 miles away. So that's, again, not too bad, but you do have to travel a little bit. And then for Davison, which I believe is a little bit farther out in Genesee County, you'll have to forgive me, I'm not a native Michigander. But for Davison, there is one facility and it's about 10 miles away in Flint. So you can get an idea just looking at Genesee County that these facilities are kind of spread out a little bit. If we were looking up in the north, that would be even farther for people to travel. So I'll talk a little bit about more risk factors and considerations. And for that, the data are broken into the prosperity regions for Michigan. So in the Flint area, that's the East Michigan region there on the thumb. I'm probably reminding myself this more than those of you who are in the thumb. I'm a little bit lower down in Metro Detroit. So cigarette smoking, like I said, is one of the big risk factors that is considered for lung cancer screening eligibility. East Michigan has about 23% of adults who smoke cigarettes, which sounds pretty good, like it's less than a quarter. But if you look at the list of the whole state, it's one of the highest three regions. So only the Northeast and Southeast are higher than East Michigan for cigarette smoking. Looking at the percentage of adults who are estimated to be eligible for lung cancer screening, Southeast Michigan has an estimated 5.3% of adults estimated to be eligible for lung cancer screening. I will say that this proportion was calculated from the state's cancer dashboard, which is really helpful if you're interested in looking at that. But even the most recent data, which are from 2021, they were looking at the prior screening recommendation, which was updated in 2021. So that was looking at adults who were 55 to 80 years old with a 30-pack year smoking history or more. And the reduction in age from 55 to 50 years and the reduction in smoking pack years from 30-pack years to 20-pack years nearly doubled the number of people who are eligible for lung cancer screening, especially among racial minorities and females. So I would expect that that percent would be quite a bit higher than what is currently showing on the cancer dashboard. But still, with that, it was estimating about 5% of people eligible for lung cancer screening. And if you look at the incidence rate, Genesee County has an incidence of 71.4 per 100,000, which is one of the higher lung cancer incidence rates in the state. In the central part of the state, there are some that are higher, around 100 per 100,000, but most of the state is more in the 50 to 60 per 100,000. So Genesee County is a bit higher than the state in general. So what we're doing about it, I'm shifting from kind of what's wrong with this to what we're doing about it. So we are working with community partners to conduct some listening sessions to really learn about barriers and facilitators for lung cancer screening, to find out from community members what might help them do lung cancer screening if they're eligible, and what might keep them from doing it if they are eligible. And we're really hoping to get input and opinions on this. So we have had a couple of these in Detroit just in the last couple of weeks, and they have been actually really very fun and informative events where we've gotten to talk with community members and we've gotten a lot of input and opinions on this. So we are working to have an upcoming session in Flint and aiming for a date in October. So people who would be eligible for this would be adults who are between 50 and 80 years old and who smoke currently or quit within 15 years. We aren't worrying about people's pack years. We're just looking for that age, as well as people with some level of tobacco use, and there's no shaming or stigma involved in these sessions. We're really just open to hearing about people's experience and learning from them about their perspectives on lung cancer screening. So with that, I will end, and if anybody has questions, questions, if that's okay, we can do that or just shift to the next thing.
Kristen, oh my goodness, that was amazing. Actually, you had two of us who were geeking out.
Sorry.
All right. No, I will stop sharing also.
Listening to me be like, did you know actually? So sorry about that.
It was really good. We want to have you back and we want to do find out more, especially when you were showing the maps of what was it, smoking, like eligible for screening and kind of do some comparisons statewide. Like, I don't think, you know, one area is popping up versus another. But nonetheless, information for us here in Flint and Genesee County says that there's work to be done.
That
needs to be done. We need to make screening more accessible and more comfortable for folks.
Yes.
You know, it would be super hard to, if, you know, my physician recommended to get screening if I thought I was going to get a $400 bill.
Yeah.
For screening, something like that. So to really sort through those, we're excited about the listening sessions. Brittany has some ideas too about where to hold the listening sessions. And I know you've been working with Nurse T and Dr. G, maybe doing some at Hasselbring. So we will keep our webinar attendees informed about those listening sessions because we're always grateful for opportunities to get community input on how do we make this better. We know we got to do it. We know we want to make sure that we're reaching out to the folks who are eligible and who could benefit from having either a plan for how to address something that could be a problem or some comfort knowing that there is no issue for them. So lots of good stuff. We are going we've got dual moderators. I love it today.
Yeah.
We should do it this way all the time. So we are going to transition and welcome Dr. Keith. Yep. Oh, and Kristen, the door's open. So come back. We want to find out the results from the listening session. So let's just extend that invitation for you to come back and share the results. And maybe we could do some kind of focus group or like not focus group, but, you know, invite a group in and broadcast from one of the senior centers and do some live updates or something. Anyways.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Yeah, we're going to start cooking up ideas. But Dr. English, join us and tell us what we need to know about vaccines. If you have slides, feel free to share them. We're excited to hear from you.
Thanks for having me. And I'll warn you that I'm having that unstable internet message here at home. So if I disappear, I might have to log back on, but hopefully it's okay right now. Yeah, let me share screen here. So I sort of put together what I think will be fairly brief remarks, for me anyway, I'm pretty long-winded, that it's sort of a combination of two different sorts of talks I've been giving around the state for many years. One of them is a talk about vaccine efficacy and everything that the incredible improvements in human health that have resulted because of the development of vaccines. And I'll talk about that a little bit. And then connected to that, sometimes I talk more extensively about the problem or the challenge of vaccine hesitancy. And so I'm going to try to do a mashup of those two talks over the next few minutes. And I think I'm going to highlight some of both and maybe have a little time to answer questions. Let's see if I can go to slideshow. There we go. Can
perfect.
You see okay?
Yep. Thank you.
You're welcome. So I am a pediatric infectious disease physician, and I'll talk a little bit about my background and how it's relevant to this in just a minute. I do want to thank three colleagues who I have used some of resources from them in a variety of talks really over the past decade or more. Janet Gilsdorf, my good friend, who retired after being the head of pediatric infectious diseases in Ann Arbor for many years. Gary Marshall, a leading advocate for strategies to overcome vaccine hesitancy at the University of Louisville. And Bob Frink in Cincinnati Children's, who was the good friend of mine from many years ago, who was the lead investigator on the pediatric COVID-19 vaccine trials in the United States. So I'm going to say a little bit about how great immunizations are and how many lives have been saved. I'm going to talk a little bit about one specific vaccine that made such an impact in my career. And then I'll talk about COVID-19 and COVID-19 vaccines and the problems we've had related to vaccine hesitancy and how concerns about COVID-19 vaccines made overall vaccine hesitancy worse. So anybody for 50 cents, anybody know who this person is? Famous painting in the history of immunizations. That's Edward Jenner immunizing James Phipps, a little boy in his practice, with a smallpox vaccine that he actually was using, in this case, cowpox, or its cousin, from a milkmaid famously named Sarah Neems. These are three of the most important names in the history of immunizations. And so he didn't really come up with this idea. He had learned from farmers in Germany and England that when smallpox swept through a community, sometimes milkmaids did not get sick. And milkmaids had these lesions on their arms from milking cows from the cousin virus, cowpox. And he thought, and other people had thought before him, that maybe that's why they didn't get sick. He had the idea, turned out to be a good one, to immunize someone with that material from those cowpox lesions. However, what he did next wouldn't qualify as very ethical, I think, under any circumstances. He challenged James Phipps twice with live smallpox virus that could have killed him had he developed smallpox, but he didn't. He was, in fact, protected. And based on that experience, Edward Jenner became the person that popularized the smallpox vaccine. He didn't really invent it. As Francis Galton said in Science, credit goes to the man or woman who convinces the world, not the man or woman that had the idea first. So Edward Jenner is the first name you often see in the history of immunization. More sophisticated physicians and scientists followed in his wake, including the genius Louis Pasteur, who first developed rabies vaccine, and pretty much we owe the germ theory of disease to. Polio vaccine came along the year before I was born, 1955. My parents still remember lining up to get me that vaccine when I was an infant. Smallpox was eradicated from the surface of the earth in 1979. I say that the last human case was in 79. There may still be some stores of smallpox virus hidden away in a freezer somewhere, but we don't think there are. Anyway, the last wild type human case was in 1978 in a tragic lab accident in 1979. A laboratory worker in Birmingham, England died from smallpox that was acquired as an error or, you know, a safety issue in a lab. The director of the laboratory committed suicide, and that smallpox source was eliminated. So that's sort of the back history. During my career, the most important development in vaccines, at least in the United States, I would say, has been the Haemophilus influenza type B polysaccharide vaccine, or the HIB vaccine. In 1985, a good vaccine was licensed that worked in older children and adults. Unfortunately, the disease was most common in toddlers, and that vaccine didn't work in them until some smart people like Anderson, Smith, Robbins, and Schneerson figured out you could fool the immune system by making a so-called conjugate vaccine when you connected a polysaccharide, which young infants do not respond to well, to a protein, and then fool the immune system to develop an immune response against both the protein and the polysaccharide. And that vaccine was so successful that within 4 years, invasive disease caused by this pathogen was almost eliminated. It still occurs very rarely in this country. And Anderson, Smith, Robbins, and Schneerson won the Lasker Award for this. Many people thought they would win the Nobel Prize, but they never did. And several of these folks have passed away now. And as you know, the Nobel Prize is not awarded posthumously. Anyway, how do vaccines work? Well, we either give you some antibody straight away by passively giving you antibody. That's how the new RSV preventive is going to work for newborns, for example. Or more usually, we actively immunize you with something that's going to trigger your body to produce an immune response that will protect you when you encounter the pathogen. That might be a whole organism that's been inactivated or weakened in some way, or it might be part of a microbe, like a protein or a polysaccharide. And then the response that you get, and this is often not well understood by lay folks in particular, isn't the same for every vaccine. Sometimes the vaccine doesn't prevent you from being colonized with the organism, diphtheria, but it keeps you from getting the disease because you have an antibody against the toxin. Or it may prevent invasion, or it may allow you to neutralize the pathogen. Many viruses, for example, doesn't prevent you necessarily from getting the infection. That's something people didn't understand about COVID vaccine. But if you do get the infection, you're likely to have less severe disease. So this is one of my favorite charts of all time, and I have a more updated version, but I keep showing the same one because it makes the point pretty well. Here's for folks that say, gee, have vaccines really done anything for us in the United States? Because I think a lot of people know about the worldwide impact of vaccines, but look at these numbers. From early in the 20th century, at least 500,000 people got measles, and that's clearly an underestimate. In 2006, when there was a small outbreak, we had 55 cases. Diphtheria eliminated, mumps uncommon, pertussis not as much for reasons I don't have to talk about today, but still 90% of the cases reduced. Rubella eliminated in the United States. There is no endemic transmission of so-called German measles. Haemophilus influenza type B, the one I was talking about a minute ago, from 20,000 to 29, polio eliminated in the United States, etc. So just in 20 years, the CDC estimated that about 730,000 deaths were prevented in the United States, about 332 million illnesses prevented, and I already gave an example of some diseases that we don't see endemic spread in the United States anymore. Globally, of course, it's an even bigger deal. It's estimated that at least 300 or 400 million people died from smallpox around the world in the 20th century. Nobody's died from smallpox since 1979. We can try to estimate whether that would have been another billion people who would have died. You know, a lot of people would have died. About 2.5 million deaths are prevented by immunizations around the world. And WHO estimates that more than 20 million deaths from measles were prevented in a 15-year period there. We still have work to do. This slide's a little out of date, but it's still the case that it's probably less than 10% now, but still a large number of deaths in children around the world are still vaccine preventable. Thank goodness we're doing pretty well, thanks to philanthropy and organizations like the Gates Foundation. We still have kids, though, that die from vaccine preventable diseases. So this allows me to briefly tell the story of one of those pathogens, Haemophilus influenzae type B. And yes, it was called Haemophilus influenzae because it was falsely thought to be the cause of influenza because it was isolated from a few people who had H flu pneumonia complicating the flu during the 1918 pandemic and before that. So this organism was the most feared organism when I was a medical student and resident and fellow in pediatrics. So I briefly mentioned the story of one of the most outstanding and pioneering female scientists in history, Margaret Pittman, at the Rockefeller. She's the person that understood, that discovered really this organism that had, I mean, other people had reported it, but she found it, discovered that it had something called a capsule, which she didn't know at the time was a polysaccharide coat. She figured out there were different serotypes through painstaking research that took forever, something we could do in 15 minutes today with modern technology. She determined the difference between people that had recovered from illness with different forms of this organism. And she figured out that what we call today Haemophilus influenza type B was the bad one out of the whole group, the one most likely to cause severe disease for reasons that we partly understand and that Dr. Gilsdorf at Michigan, who I borrowed these slides from, helped elucidate. This is probably the most famous article in the history of pediatric infectious disease immunology in terms of leading to vaccine development. So in 1932, Father Gill and Wright published a famous paper. They knew that this organism, Haemophilus influenzae, was a leading cause of meningitis in young children. You probably can't see the axis over here, but these cases are all in the first year of life and then the second year of life, et cetera. And you'll see that almost all the cases of H. flu meningitis occurred in infants and toddlers. That's why the vaccine wasn't any good for us, really, when you could only give it here at 2 years of age. So they discovered that, and they realized that, but the discovery they made was they wondered why that might be. So they did a wonderful and simple experiment. They took blood from a lot of children from different ages. They incubated this organism at the time called B influenzae. They incubated the organism with blood. And what they discovered was there was something in the blood of these older children that killed the bacteria. Infants didn't have it. Of course, that was neutralizing antibody. They didn't know that. But this discovery led people to say, well, whatever that is, if we could trigger a way for you to make that, maybe you won't get invasive disease if you're an infant or toddler. That really was a remarkable paper for what, 91 years ago. So thanks to them and this observation and the idea that there was something in there, which now we know are capsular antibodies, led to the development of Haemophilus influenza type B vaccine. So when I was training in pediatrics in the 1980s, this was far and away the leading cause of bacterial meningitis in children. It caused more disease than all the other causes put together. And it caused a lot of other serious illnesses, septic arthritis of the joint, cellulitis, a terrible condition called epiglottitis that could kill you because you would suffocate from the epiglottis being enlarged. And at the time I trained at Texas Children's, we had more than 100 children a year, imagine that, admitted to the hospital with invasive disease caused by this organism. That meant every time I was on the pediatric inpatient service at Texas Children's, every time, there would be several children on our team who were recovering, hopefully, from severe disease due to this path. That's how common it was. And so it was, again, as I showed you earlier, mainly in these younger infants. The peak age was about 6 months. It started going away by age 18 months to 2 years. Here is the organism. It's those little coccobacilli for any bacteriologists in the group. It's not really stained enough that you can see that these are faintly gram-negative coccobacilli. Here's a child that had buccal cellulitis. That's a very firm, indurated area. Also had a bloodstream infection with this organism. Here's a child who had life-threatening sepsis, survived, but lost hand from this condition. This is a cause of the condition known as purpura fulminans, which we think of more with meningococcemia, but occurred with this organism in kids. So it's a terrible disease. And here's what Porter Williams and the other folk, Porter Anderson and his colleagues, figured out. They said, okay, what if we took this polysaccharide, which gets a wimpy response by B cells from young infants? They do have some response, but they don't make any memory cells. They make a little bit of antibody, not much. It doesn't last long. There's no boost when we give it to them again. So they figured out, hey, let's take this polysaccharide and connect it to a carrier protein. Young infants respond just fine to diphtheria vaccine, for example, or tetanus toxoid. And that's what they chose. They chose things like diphtheria toxoid, tetanus toxoid. They just linked it to the polysaccharide using pretty rudimentary chemistry. And this, when you gave this to an infant, actually the response to the first dose wasn't much better. The magic was in the second dose. So the second and third doses of all these conjugate vaccines, you get a dramatic memory response. You get more antibody made. You get better antibody made. Long story, you get a good response. So Smith and Anderson really were involved with this. I got to meet them right after they won the Lasker Award. Really remarkable. And the vaccine was licensed and the disease went away. This is the kind of disease curve we'd like to see for every disease known to man. You won't see it very often during your career. 11,000 cases in 1987. Remember, there had been 20,000 cases a year in some previous years before we had any vaccine. Here it's licensed in 1988. Boom. 30 cases in whatever this year was, 2000. We had a case about 8 years ago in Lansing. That's one case in the 10 years I've been in Michigan. So that's a remarkable story. I could show you other stories like the measles vaccine, but I won't. Let's just talk about COVID-19 and COVID-19 vaccines and the challenge of vaccine hesitancy. So everybody remembers that back in 2020 and 2021, the first swing of the COVID pandemic, it was recognized early on that most of the severe disease was in the elderly folks or in adults with underlying conditions. If you look at these epidemic curves, there are always some cases being reported in children less than 4, 5 to 12, but you didn't see much until teenage years. It was falsely thought at one point that kids weren't really getting the disease. That turned out to be wrong. They were being infected. Fortunately, in general, they do have and still do have milder disease, which is good, but there were a lot of pediatric cases. So we started looking, well, you know, here's a week that there were 200,000 cases in the United States. Luckily, the severity was mild overall, but guess what? Even a milder disease that affects that many children leads to a lot of morbidity and some deaths. And we knew by this time from the adult studies before we had the pediatric vaccines, that this vaccine, the vaccinations that were available were highly effective. I could beat this to death by showing you 50 slides, but I'll just show you three or four. Here's one of the ones looking at COVID-19 associated cases in people that are unvaccinated compared to fully vaccinated. Here are deaths in people that are unvaccinated or fully vaccinated. Relative risk by October of 2021, we knew that if you were fully vaccinated versus unvaccinated, you were 5 times less likely to test positive for COVID-19 if you've been immunized. You were 14 times less likely to die from COVID-19. And then as we went to vaccinated and boosted, something similar, 10 to 20 times less risk for people that were fully vaccinated. So as of, you know, a year and a half ago, we were finally getting COVID vaccines for children, and it was easy to make the case why we needed to do that, even though most children who had COVID were mildly affected. Almost 30,000 had been hospitalized. 6,400 had this condition called multi-inflammatory syndrome of children. It's a long story, but it's a post-infectious immune-mediated thing, and 735 people had died, children. So, you know, while that's not, was, thank God, much less than what we'd seen in adults, it was not trivial. And it, even at that time, we could compare and contrast and say, well, people that think we don't need to immunize kids against COVID, do they think we shouldn't immunize them against the flu? Because it's killing, you know, it was killing about 6 or 7 times as many kids as the flu was. It was killing obviously a lot more kids than some of these other diseases. If you look back at the peak incidence of chickenpox, only 50 or 60 children a year were dying from it. There's a lot of morbidity. So it's pretty clear we needed a COVID vaccine. And fortunately, we got one. Here's Bob Frink's article looking at the first of the two mRNA vaccines in kids. And I don't know if you can see all the data, it doesn't really matter. It was highly effective, as it had been shown already in the original studies. I won't spend too much time on this, but one of my favorite myths to attack is this one. Well, gosh, we just can't give anybody, a kid or anybody else, these vaccines because they were rushed and they're not safe. You know, I'm not a big fan of the Trump administration, but I'm going to give them credit for doing a good job in helping develop these vaccines rapidly. However, unfortunately, too much emphasis was placed on the rapid and not enough emphasis was placed on the fact, thank goodness, we already have this mRNA vaccine technology. We already used it to make a vaccine against SARS years ago, but thank God we never needed to use that because SARS went away. We were ready to do it. Had there been a little more emphasis on we were ready to do it, it's safe, it's great, it would have maybe been a little bit better received. But the bottom line is that not only was it studied appropriately, at this stage, I can say this is the most heavily, extensively studied vaccine in human history. Hundreds of millions of people have received it. Extremely safe, very rare serious side effects, and even those are very, even more rare in the mRNA vaccines. The adenovirus-based vaccine did have a rare, but sometimes fatal complication, particularly in older women, of an unusual clotting disorder that occurred because of the vaccine. That's not seen with the mRNA vaccine. So it's a very safe vaccine. It can't give you COVID because there's no virus in there. It doesn't make you infertile, doesn't change your DNA. It does protect against the new variants, although, as you heard earlier, the new booster that's just been released, based on everything we know, is going to be a little bit more effective than the previous vaccine, so I do recommend getting that one. So the bottom line is, this is an extensively studied, very safe vaccine, and thank goodness we have this technology, because we're going to need to use mRNA vaccine technology again in the future, I think, when a new pandemic arrives. So given all that, why aren't more people being immunized against COVID-19? It's expected that the update of this new booster is going to be very mediocre. Well, we have an underlying problem before any COVID-19 existed, which is that there's a fair amount of vaccine hesitancy or refusal that's been influenced by information, some of that deliberate disinformation. And I don't have time to talk about it today, but I'd be happy to talk for an hour sometime about Andrew Wakefield and the whole business about falsely claiming that MMR caused autism, something that definitely led to kids dying from measles. There's no question about it. So first of all, there's bad information and misinformation, et cetera. So that's one thing. But legitimately, people do have reasons to be concerned about our healthcare system and not trust the system that doesn't always do a good job of dealing with their needs or understanding their circumstances or providing access to care. And so we have this background rate of vaccine hesitancy, which got worse during COVID-19. Now, here's an old study from 2009, but it's still relevant. If you talk to families about, you know, most families understood vaccines were important. Most of them knew vaccines were safe. Some didn't. Some of the concerns that parents had were absolutely understandable. Pain from multiple shots given in one visit. Lord knows we wish we had, you know, inhaled or nasal vaccines for everything and didn't have to give anybody an intramuscular injection ever. We're not there yet. I mean, we had a vaccine that was extremely effective for oral polio, right? The oral polio vaccine. And believe me, kids preferred getting that than an injection. But unfortunately, that vaccine very rarely caused polio in somebody that had an immune deficiency. So we didn't use it after a while. This idea that kids get too many vaccines in one visit is partly true and partly false. The idea that they kind of have to get two or three different shots, I get that. That's anxiety provoking for kids. And we wish we didn't have to do it. We wish if we had to give an injection, if we had to give five vaccines, wouldn't it be better if we could give one injection? We can't do that unless they've been studied and we know that they can be safely given that way. But the idea that getting too many vaccines is dangerous for your immune system is nonsense. The average kid will be exposed to more antigens tomorrow afternoon if he or she plays in a sandbox than all of the vaccines that that person will receive in their life. So that's a nonsense thing. But the child's doctor, nurse, other primary care provider is the person most likely to persuade a hesitant family to vaccinate their kids. I already mentioned this idea that vaccines cause diseases, not true, that vaccines cause autism, extensively debunked, was never a real concern ever. But there is something different. I'm just going to end here in just a minute. I wanted to mention briefly this business about the psychology of regret, because I think this does have an impact on vaccine hesitancy. The idea is that, and there's a lot of extensive evidence for this from psychologists and sociologists and others. The idea is that human beings tend to worry about the worst case scenario. So if we're told, you know, there's a very rare side effect of this vaccine that we're going to give your child today, we're more likely to focus on that rare thing than we are on what might happen if the child, you know, got the disease. And I get that. So many people think, well, you know, maybe my child won't get COVID-19 or they won't get sick from it. But we're more likely to be worried about something that we're doing positively, giving a vaccine, than something that's a theoretical risk in the future. There's a fair amount of evidence this is true. So that doesn't help. So the way we do better is we don't do better by browbeating or lecturing folks or piling a bunch of articles and saying, hey, go read this and you'll learn that what you learned on TikTok is not correct. What we have to do is provide positive information and be respectful of concerns that families have. We do need to emphasize the incredible impact of immunizations on child health, but you know what? I don't vote for showing parents pictures of that kid's hand. You know, that's not good. And it doesn't work. Actually, people have tried sort of the scare tactic. If you don't immunize your kid's going to get this terrible disease and die. Well, that's probably not true in the United States. Even during an outbreak, I wouldn't tell somebody, oh, if you don't immunize them, it's likely your child's going to get this. But it is true that the risk of the disease is greater than that of the vaccine. And we need to be able to communicate that. And what we need, frankly, is we need more and better communication from positive influencers on social media and in communities and peers and teenagers. What we don't need are a bunch of experts that say, this is the way it is. If you're only smart enough to know what I know, you know, you do it. That doesn't work. I did say that most studies show that at least half of vaccine hesitant families will eventually decide to immunize their kids if you're respectful and you work with them. So I think we ought to do that. I don't like kicking anybody out of your practice if they don't immunize their kids. But if you're having an outbreak of measles in the community, I'd have to tell people in my practice, you can't come to my clinic now unless it's, you know, Friday afternoon at 5 o'clock. I can't have your kid around some other kid in my clinic. They might get measles. So there's a middle ground there. And last but not least, I'm not aware of any actual philosophy that has philosophical exemptions for vaccines. And another topic for another day is that no major religion prohibits the use of vaccines. So most religious exemptions are not based on, they're basically based on personal religious views and not based on the principles or teaching of any major religion, what that's worth. And last but not least, as pediatricians anyway, we need to be positive. We need to say, hey, we've got these vaccines your child needs to get today, and here's what they protect against. I'm a big fan of shared decision-making, but that doesn't mean you say, you know, I don't know if you have a vaccine or not. What do you think? I mean, we went to medical school. We know about these things. We should give the advice that we think is the best thing for people and their families. So anyway, that's my spiel. I'm done.
Oh my goodness. That was amazing. So much wonderful information that we could just go into further. I know Brittany has some follow-up points.
I mean, it's a very difficult act to follow, Dr. English, with all of that amazing information. I guess I wanted to talk maybe really briefly, because I was just at one of the American Academy of Pediatrics conferences, and they were talking a lot about the way that vaccines are framed when we're having the discussion, and how some of the important points, not you said all the right things, but some of the important points of the way that we discuss the vaccines with families and with each other, and how that can actually change some of our thinking around that. And so there was a couple big points, and I think some of it, you know, we had always thought a lot of scare tactics. You got to let them know about that and how we're really working away from that. And that how to describe like how the vaccine works in the body. And before we were always talking about war and going to battle and all of these different things like that, that might have some negative connotations to it. Again, you know, violence is probably not something we want to be talking about with your child. We don't want to equate that to that. So talking about actually, we would use a computer metaphor, particularly when it comes to booster vaccines. That we were saying that the computer had to install this program, and then I had to do updates every now and then. And that's really what we're doing when we're doing giving the vaccines. It's that we're programming your child's immune system to be able to fight these infections better in the future. And again, that doesn't mean that your computer might not get a virus, pun intended, but that they're going to be able to fight it off better and alert you that something is going on a little bit better. And not have some of those dire consequences. You're not going to lose your entire hard drive anymore. You might just have to debug it for a little bit.
I like that analogy. I think that's great.
Yeah, and I felt like it was very hip and with the times, with the technology times too. And again, it kind of took that negative connotation off. It made me, you know, and I like to pretend that I am very tech savvy. So I like that as well. So that was one of the big things that we kind of talked about at the American Academy of Pediatrics conference this year. They have a whole, like, I'm looking at the document now, but it's like a 49-page document about all this research they did around and they call it term framing of this, which is amazing. And I, of course, goes beyond just with talking about vaccines, but any discussion with the family as well about these decisions. So I really like that one. And then one of the big points, and then the other point that I really like to talk about too, is that in America, we love individual freedom. We like to think about things on an individual basis. And sometimes we need to talk about it as more of a community basis to kind of understand where the public health impact comes in. It's not just your child, it's the child next door and different things like that. And again, kind of holding a little bit of accountability with that has been helpful, that even if it doesn't prevent an illness in your child, that it's about, you know, protecting the entire community that you live in and other loved ones and things like that. I always have a family member think about, you know, with COVID, I've thought, you know, your grandparent, your aunt or uncle, someone that at a church or the grocery store or works with you, or your next door neighbor that helps you weed or helped you move into your house and things like that it's about protecting those individuals and kind of giving a face to the community that you live in, that the vaccine is not only protects your child, but the people around you from it. And I think that's a really big part about that too. So,
Dr. English.
I just wanted to say I agree with that wholeheartedly, and I actually had a slide that I took out about the community benefit. I think, and I'm guilty of this as well as everybody else. It's easy these days to be pretty cynical when you see a lot of evidence in the world that people are not that communitarian, you know, that they're not worried about their neighbor enough. But I think we should be optimist, and we should emphasize that. One of the things that we do in our line of work too is sometimes we emphasize the fact that, you know, this flu shot is not available for children less than 6 months. Mm-hmm. If you have a child in your home less than 6 months, or at your church or wherever, and that child gets flu from your child, that child's at higher risk to have a bad outcome than your child. So this altruism, I think, if you help people understand that, the other people in the community that cannot get vaccines are the ones that are severely immunocompromised. Now, there, I think that might be a middle ground that is effective. There are a number of parents of children with severe immunocompromise that make ads and work with iVaccinate and so forth to say, look, my child has this disease and cannot receive these vaccines. Please immunize your children to reduce the risk that my child will get the vaccine. That's sort of a tug on your heartstrings that I think is completely ethical. No one's coercing the parent to doing it, of course. If the parent wants to do that, I say more power to them. That's a powerful message.
So important. So we're headed into fall. We're in fall now, actually. What are some of the vaccines that, you know, we should be getting for our kids?
Brittany or I can tackle that. There are a couple of special ones.
Do it.
The special vaccines are the new COVID-19 booster and the flu shot, right? For older people like me, over 65, you should also get the new RSV vaccine. RSV, once again, causes disease more in folks a little bit older than me, not just over 65, but again, you might help reduce spread to someone else. And so it's a safe vaccine. Of course, it's famous as the most common virus that causes young children to be admitted to the hospital. Anything we can do to reduce the spread is good. So older folks like me should get the RSV vaccine. Everybody should get the new COVID-19 booster and your flu shot, and you can get them on the same day. Same arm. I usually get them different arms. I'm getting mine next week. And the reason I waited is I know that in most years, flu peaks later than it does. If you get your flu vaccine like the 1st of September, you may be getting a little less bang for your buck. I usually get mine in early October, so it's a little more likely to last throughout flu season. Either way, it's good. So my wife and I are getting ours next week, the new COVID booster and the flu shot.
All right. So any others for kids, any other vaccines that you'd recommend? I know there's the normal, infant vaccine regimen and stuff like that. Any that come to mind that folks might be a little bit more hesitant to get that we should really advocate for?
That's a good question. They're all important. Remember that the ones that are for young infants, like these conjugate ones, you really need to get them early. The folks like Dr. Sears that have said, oh, well, just you can get your vaccines, but let's space them all out over 5 years. That doesn't make any sense. Many of those germs are the highest risk as young infancy. So getting that one on time at 2 months and getting the next one at 4 months is very important, because that's when you get your maximum protection after that second dose. So I would stress the importance of getting that primary series of vaccines at 2, 4, and 6 months. And yeah, everything else is important. I mean, one of the vaccines that, and I know Brittany's interested in adolescent health like I am, one of the vaccines that people are often reluctant to give to their kids is the HPV vaccine. Yeah. And the problem there is people are better maybe at understanding the short-term risk of a thing compared to thinking, well, if you get HPV, you might get cervical cancer or penile cancer 35 years from now. And I understand the time horizon thing. That's part of the reason we think that vaccine has not been taken up as much. So that's one that we definitely have a problem with hesitancy. And frankly, what I think works best there, you're talking about tech approaches where you actually communicate with the adolescents themselves using technology, using peers, using social media. Say, don't you want to get this vaccine that would reduce the risk that you could get cancer one day? Guess what? They want to get the vaccine. And of course, States differ in terms of what the age is where you can consent to do something with or without parental approval. But I think particularly for adolescent vaccines, communicating directly to the adolescent is the best strategy.
Huge. And you, well, the three of us have some friends at MSU that are working in that area. That we'll have to have come on and talk about different methods of reaching those young adults. They're doing some really innovative research.
That'd be a great idea to invite, to invite them to come on. I think that'd be wonderful. Dr. Argyris and Dr. Chan, our new faculty member.
Yeah, we'd love that. All right. We have landed this webinar so well today. Thank you all for joining us. Well, that's all right. We can do this together. That's all right. We'll do this. I don't want to forget. We are moving to a monthly schedule for the webinar. So we won't be here next week. We will be here the second Friday of every month. So please join us on the 13th of October. We're going to have some amazing speakers lined up. And you can always check out our YouTube channel that has the archived versions. You know, community health workers, you are near and dear to us, always in our heart. Get those CEUs. That link will pop up once you exit the webinar. And we will see you next. Oh, no, we won't. I almost forgot. We'll see you in 2 weeks. We'll see you in 2 weeks, and we'll look forward to coming back together as a webinar family. Thanks so much.